Hi there, it's Freeman Stephen. It's the last day of March 2012, which makes it the 31st of March. I've did a few videos and I haven't uploaded them. I'm using this new camera which I've had for like over a year now, and every time I make a video on it, it gets kind of, well, no scrap, but it just doesn't get uploaded because I'm always making some sort of small mistake and my narcissism prevents me from uploading it and making a complete fool of myself. This is where I'm living just now. I've had this shelter built for about a month. When I say built, it's an ongoing process. It's been built to the extent where I can now sleep inside it. It has a window, but it also has a tent inside. It also happens to have a window. You can maybe see me through there when it's dark. Or see me in the reflection in my new window. What have I been doing? Over the past, I planted some crops, kind of like at the start of March, like peas and the potatoes that I had left over from last year. And what happened was, I thought frost had passed completely, but it had only kind of gone away while the cloud cover was keeping the place warm. As soon as the cloud cover went out, there was like ice puddles and stuff like that. So I don't think the crops that I've planted are going to be very good. However, scraping some of the hay, which is blowing over this patch here, I can see that some of the peas have actually taken root and are now nice and green and growing. I'll need to stake them so that they've got something to cling on to as they grow old over the space of a year. So the peas have grown despite the clear icy conditions at the start of March. I noticed there was a wee tinge of frost last night, and there's weather people predicting that there's going to be snow just past the 1st of April. I reckon that there is going to be a cold spell, but I don't reckon it's going to be as bad as snow as some people are saying. So the potatoes were planted in that long bed last year. This year I'm putting in peas because I hear crop rotation is a good thing. Now this is very small scale. Eventually I hope to have some means of doing all these run rigs. And the run rigs on the other side of that walkway that you can see at the other side there. Rather than just doing this small scale stuff here. There's potatoes in there, that's where the peas were last year. There's carrots in there. I haven't actually planted any carrots, that's actually perennials. I didn't know carrots were perennials, I thought the winter would kill them. But because they were so small, I didn't pick all of them out. I thought, well, I'll leave that for the spring. And I'm just going to leave them in there and maybe even plant more carrots. There's also a swede or two in there as well, perhaps. I've still to plant the swede seeds that I got last year. It seemed that all of the swede plants were kind of leafy, big swedes, and then there was one that was kind of like a small swede with like big massive flowers on it. So I reckon that must have been like a female swede or something like that, so I got some seeds for that. This one here I haven't planted anything in except more soft fruit bushes. That was the brambles that I planted last year, that one there. And that was, one's raspberry, one's brambles, one's red currant. I've basically planted more soft fruit bushes, which I didn't get any fruit last year from. But I was expecting that, because you don't get fruit in the first year of planting like a fruit bush or a fruit tree. But I've also came to the conclusion that I maybe need a pair of each, a pair of brambles, a pair of red currant, a pair of raspberry. There's also something called a Logan fruit. This one here, I believe, is red currant. That one is either raspberry, that one's bramble. They're all very much the same. I can't remember, it was last year that I planted them, so I can't remember right. I've planted this one here was either a red currant or there was a double of red currant, raspberry or bramble, but it didn't actually grow. this one here and that one there have just been planted. That one appears to be sprouting, that one appears to be doing nothing, even though it's been in the soil from like early March. There's also something coming up here which looks familiarly like a bramble or a red currant. But outside of these soft fruit bushes, I haven't actually planted anything in this bed here. This bed here, I planted some rice. This was the first bed that I dug that I threw like just a pile of seeds into, and I couldn't work out what was what once it finally grew. But it was my first like amazing, wow, it's a jungle when I came back one day, because I wasn't actually living here permanently at the time. And I came back after like a couple of weeks absence, and it was like overgrown with like food. I'd rather herbs, it was more herbs rather than food, like sort of the medicinal plants rather than actual foody stuff. There was radishes though. I eventually worked out one of the plants was radish. When I say medicinal, what I mean is like plants that are on the like wholesome diet, but rather sort of flavourings and that. But there was plenty of radish. This year I planted rice in it just to see if it would grow. There's no growth in it at all so far. But on top of that, on top of the rice, I've also threw in birdseed to try and get the chickens some sort of like self-sustaining food resource, rather than buying them corn all the time. They can have corn for their own planting here. I've thrown in melon seeds as well, and basically anything at all. I'm just hoping that the rice will grow. I'm expecting that the bird seeds will grow no problem at all, because last year like one of the shelters was overrun with bird seeds that I didn't actually plant, that had just fallen in the ground. This one here isn't exactly a bed yet, but I'm digging it. I've dug round the side. I've just to basically cut it into chunks and then break that down into fine, friable soil. Now, as well as that, so I've got a new shelter. That was a wigwam I was in last year. This is a shelter that I was in last summer. I've torn some of the tarpaulin from the wigwam to build that, and I'm still in the process of demolishing this. There's still stuff inside that which I need. So I'm in the process of taking all that stuff and putting it in there, and then demolishing that and using the kind of structure, the structural wood, for something else. I'm not sure what yet, maybe a fence, maybe something else. This here is a circle of fruit trees which I've recently planted over the past couple of days. I've took the precaution of buying things in pairs now. Now, I don't mean this to be a pun, but that's a pear tree, and that's a pear tree. Those are called birch pear, or birch pear, I think it's some sort of French word, B-E-U-R-R-E-E. That's how it's spelled there. So that's a pair of birch pears. These are conference pears, which are kind of like the sort of the traditional pear shape, kind of elongated, sort of hardy pears that you that are so common in Britain, or at least in Scotland, for eating. This one here, this pear here, that's a pair of conference pears, a pair of boar pears. These two here are a pair of Golden Delicious. I've also got a pair of Cox's Orange, which I think is the same as a Cox's Pippin, but I'm not sure. It's described as Cox's Orange, and it looks like a Cox's Pippin, so maybe it is. These two here are Czar Plums. There doesn't appear to be any growth on this. The growth that you see is basically growth that was there when I bought it out of the box. And the leaves have maybe sort of formed a wee bit more over the past couple of days with this one, because the Czar Plums were planted like yesterday. And basically all the trees you've seen so far were planted yesterday. Now the trees here, there's also over here next to that's the brewery pears. This one is a Stella cherry. These two are Stella cherries, and I planted them yesterday, and the leaves were kind of like, oh no, we're not going to get enough soil or sunlight, so we're all going to just shrivel up. But now the leaves are coming out, And that was only like a couple of days ago I planted them. Now, today, or last night, I brought in another 4 trees to complete a circle of 16 trees. So beside the Tsar plums, I've got Victoria plums. These two here are Victoria plums. And I've got 2 more Stella cherries. I actually wanted sunburst cherries, so that I'd have a pair of pears kind of thing, that aren't pears, a pair of pears that are cherries. So I would have had a pair of Stella cherries and a pair of sunburst cherries, but I couldn't find any sunburst cherries, so I've now got 4 Stella cherries, 2 burr pears, 2 conference pears, 2 golden delicious, 2 Cox's pippin, 2 Tsar plums and 2 Victoria plums. Which means I've got 4 cherry trees, 4 apple trees and 4 pear trees. And that's basically the food that's been planted so far. I've got loads more seeds. I don't think the potatoes are coming up too well, which I planted in early March. So I've got more potatoes. It was Maris Piper that I planted last year, and that was the kind of the savings that I made for last year, which haven't grown, which is a bit of a disappointment. But it could be because I didn't chip them well enough, and it could also be because I planted them too early. And saying that, I planted the peas too early and they appear to be growing okay. I've also got King Edward. I've just avoided Maris Piper because I just thought they were too small. Once I started picking them, I had to pick them kind of like, I think it was like October, November or something like that, because the chickens were picking them first. And I thought, if I don't pick them now, I'm not going to be picking them at all. So, I've got more potatoes, but I've avoided Maris Piper because they're too small. I've also got onions, garlic, and various other bits and pieces which I can't quite remember. And of course, I'll be buying more as I dig more. So it's March. I've got plenty of food. I've got my scarecrow up, but the scarecrow is kind of, it's falling apart, you know. I gave it limbs and stuff like that, and now it's like a poor disabled scarecrow. So I'm going to have to fix the scarecrow as well. The shelter's got a door on it, which doesn't have it's not properly built, or it's not properly hung, if you know what I mean. Basically the hinges are bits of rope. But it does swing, as you can see, but it still doesn't have a proper frame to it, and I'll need to do the hinges a wee bit better as well. So basically, you can't even read the sign on the windows, because I've got this in front to cover for the fact that I don't have a proper frame on it. So basically that door's supposed to protect the chickens, not only from predators, but also from like wind and drafts and stuff like that. And the only way to avoid drafts is to put that big X airbed over it. I say an X airbed because it's kind of like burst and it's got holes torn into it and that. So now it's just basically a skin. This shelter here is going to come down. I'm going to use one of these big logs kind of to cut through. That's the plan anyway, to cut a frame out of these, but I'm thinking there might be an easier solution. These are massive and I did plan on using them to build a proper bridge with over by, because the bridge that I built the August before last is it's falling apart, and at times you still need to walk over it with Wellington boots, because it's really just like a couple of logs that have been placed over a stream. So that's basically what's been happening. I'm building up a pile of hay, because hay always comes in handy. If not for bedding for the chickens, it comes in handy for bedding for me. It's more comfortable than a bed, hay. I don't know why people don't sleep in hay. I suppose because it's so fucking flammable that they can't have it in their ordinary houses. And it's also handy for lighting fires as well. You don't need a kind of like a, what do you feel, like a fire cube, one of the kind of paraffin dipped Zippo fire lighter things. You don't need one of them if you get hay. So I'm collecting a pile of hay. I'm also collecting a pile of soil, which I'm going to use for kind of composting. When you pull this stuff out the ground, it's basically soggy. And if I'm going to make it friable, which means it into sort of wee granular particles, you need it to be quite dry, so that you can kind of scrabble it up into small like seeding pots and stuff like that, which is something I did plant, which I haven't mentioned. I've got a pile of sort of like seedings here. There's lettuce. I don't know if you can see that in the camera behind the window. There's lettuce in these tubs here. Something else in that tub. I think marrow's in one of those tubs. And there's something else as well. There's melon or something in the wee black ones. And these are like pots that I bought for £1 out of Asda. Oh, which reminds me, guess how much my trees were? £3 each. So these are kind of like herbs. Oregano, bay leaf salad, thyme, coriander, various stuff like that. I've also got more pots in the window, which you might have seen before. Some of these are growing. Pumpkin, courgette, tomatoes, which aren't growing yet. I've got peppers, rocket, French beans, and various other bits and pieces. So that's basically what I've planted, what I've been doing. If you remember, I built a bench. Was it last summer or was it the summer before? It must have been last summer. I built a bench. I sat in it this morning and crack. Now, that doesn't seem that important because I can always repair that again, right? But it's the very principle of wood, which seemed to be quite okay when I built the thing, which now cracks when I sit on top of it. Now, translate that to the fact that shelters are built out of the same shit. So I'm thinking of serious concerns regarding my structures, building out of wood. And I've discovered the kind of investigation is that, see this thing here, is less likely to suffer rot because the bark has been stripped off it, whereas this thing having bark is more likely to suffer from rot. For some reason, the thing that rots is kind of contained in the bark. I don't know whether it maybe attracts the fungus, which rots the wood, or something like that anyway. So that's another thing to mention. What else? I've also bought a book on mushrooms, and I've managed to identify some of the mushrooms that grow here that I couldn't identify before. And one of the kind of most common mushrooms around here, which don't grow yet, is the yellow, the egg yolk yellow. It started appearing sort of like mid-June last year, just before I got the chickens. Or was it mid-May? I got them on the 1st of June. Or was it the end of June? I don't know, they appeared just before I got the chickens, so we're talking like May or June. And they're sort of like bright egg yolk yellow, which that's why I remember I got them round about the time of the chickens. And I couldn't identify what they were, but if I could eat them, then it would be great. But because I couldn't identify them, I thought it's a wee bit too dangerous. It turns out they're called some form of rudula, which I can't remember now. But it's not an edible form of rudula because it doesn't taste lovely, sweet and nice. But it's not poisonous, which means that it could be used for nutrition. But it's going to need like some spices in it, like some sort of flavouring. So even though it's inedible, it's not toxic. Find that with a lot of mushrooms. They're described as inedible, but you can't eat them. They just don't taste very nice. Now there's two mushrooms, which actually I originally thought was one mushroom, which turned out to be edible, or rather inedible. And I'll explain what I mean by this difference between edibility and toxicity. These mushrooms here, now I can't even remember what they're called, but looking up the mushroom book, I couldn't identify what these are called, and I managed to identify them, and it turns out they're completely edible. They're inedible, but not toxic kind of thing, but because they're very tough, they're quite hard to kind of chew through. So that's why they're described as being inedible. But if there's some way to soften them, then certainly I'll be eating them. Now there's actually two of the sort of bracket fungus, which I thought was the one plant at different stages in its life. But it turns out it's two different plants. And there's like, if I can just find one of the things, the other one, which is completely inedible and not toxic, because this one is like more than just tough, it's actually solid as wood itself and is therefore truly inedible. And it looks kind of like that bracket fungus I showed you there in the logs, which I'm trying to cultivate. But I can't actually find one of these. It's a wee bit sort of rounder than that and sort of flatter against the tree. I wish I could remember the names of them. Maybe I should have discovered that, or I should have looked that up before doing the video. But as my videos tend to go, they're kind of sort of like done in the spur of the moment kind of thing. No, I'm just going to have to face the fact that I can't actually find one of these sort of woods mushroom things, the woody textured mushrooms. But they kind of look like rocks stuck to a tree, you know. Now, the last thing I want to show you before ending the video is that the land is mostly silver birch. It's like all the trees around here are silver birch, right? But it's maybe at this time of year when all the leaves aren't on the trees yet that you can notice that there's a tree sitting there all by itself. It's green. I think it's a Scots pine. Could be a Norwegian spruce or something like that, I'm not sure. But it's definitely a pine tree of some description. And it just sits there all by itself with its cones on the ground. These are very good for softwood. So I'm glad to have discovered that, and I haven't actually, if you can see the trees over there, that's actually beyond the land claim. That doesn't quite count as trees that are part of Gart Beth, but this is the only tree so far that I've managed to find that isn't like a silver birch in the main part of Gart Beth. There are other trees on the other side of the stream, because there's a wee sort of peninsula of that island that's part of the Gart Beth claim. Willow, as well as plenty of silver birch, and I think there is one fir tree there as well. But outside of that, it's all kind of like silver birch. And apple, pear, and plum and cherry now as well. So that's basically my video for today on the 31st of March 2012. It's a Saturday. 1st of April will be tomorrow, which means when I'm working tonight, past midnight, I'm going to be taking the piss out of everybody that I see. We're getting on to what's called the mid-road here. And maybe this video is going on for longer than it needs to be. We're at 23 minutes 50. And this is called the mid-road because the road that all that's sort of built on is the north road. And there's another kind of road there, the south road, which is kind of like the border. Sort of being kind of 30 metres north of the power lines there. So that's basically my video for today. Freeman Stephen out.